It's just a minute before, but I'm just going to kind of start because it looks like I've kind of got a settled group. Some of the presentations you can tell you kind of just walking in slowly. It looks like we're kind of settled. By now, you've heard my name before. It's Keiki Kawai'aia. I currently oversee the Hawaiian Language College called Kahaka'ula o Ke Erikolani at UH Hilo. It's kind of along the lines as one of your recommendations of the committee or the council, I'm not too sure. The advisory council recommended yesterday to create a native languages, Alaska Native Languages College. That's what we are in Hilo. And currently, we're the only native language college in the nation. And it's very unusual to have college status, but you know, college status is about being able to create programs and new degree programs. That's the function of a college that is different than a department or a division. So that has helped us to elevate our work in revitalizing our language, because our focus is on that. That is really the primary focus of our college, and we've, through that and all of our partnerships with schools and our communities, we have been able to create a pipeline of infant, toddler to doctorate. So this title is called School Is Not Enough, The Role, Importance, and Development of Families in Revitalizing a Language. And I thought this would be a really important topic. It's one I know very close to my heart because my entrance into Olelo Hawaii was as a student, of course, but really as a parent. I was at one of the leading pioneering families that was involved in revitalizing the language. And I can't think of a more critical, committed group that is essential in revitalizing our languages. And school is the medium, is the vehicle that we've decided to revitalize our language. It has been an educational platform. So when you're revitalizing your language, you put lots of focus in on the schools, the roles of the university to help the lower L, and it is very cyclical. But school isn't enough if you're going to revitalize a language. And I want us to be thinking as you're kind of listening to the presentation of what else and what more do we need to do. Because the truth is that schools is essentially important for the revitalization of our language. But in order for it to live on, it's got to go beyond the walls of the school. It has to go beyond the walls of our immediate homes. It has to permeate our communities and go into the workforce. So we're a generation and a half into our movement, and we're beginning to see those outcomes. Because our children now that came into the lead classes of immersion are now young parents. You know, coming out of college, going into very diversified fields, even though we need lots of teachers, we need them to be at other places. Because if they don't go into other places, our language doesn't have those contexts to also live. And the broader you have your language being used on a daily basis, the more you have a larger support voice in the community to revitalize and to sustain and maintain that language. And so we found that really important, you know, just beginning with that tight, solid group of our schools and our families and getting over that, but still they're kind of in, like, in a little silo. You know, so there's schools here, schools there, schools there, and they're on mixed islands in different communities. And so many of the students, when our numbers are small, they really felt isolated. Now, we're talking about the endangered language status. You know, so it's they can feel very isolated. And who else speaks Hawaiian in there? And the power of English is so strong that to maintain the dominance of your native language in the school becomes a challenge when it's only like this. So there needs now to be, when the kids go out and play Pop Warner, they need to be playing with other children that are speaking Hawaiian in soccer and volleyball and the sports that are in our communities and the different places. So I really would like us to do some discussion into thinking about that, and I'll share some of the things that we're doing as sort of my broad thinking about that. But I think it's really important as you folks are visualizing your work ahead that you're really thinking a generation ahead. And I think for us, we were just trying to get over, what do we do today for tomorrow? Because we just didn't have enough capacity. You know, we had under 50 speakers that were native speakers of Hawaiian, and the bulk of them were in the small isolated community of Niihau, and a little, you know, 2,500 or so native speakers when we started. That's really not a strong indicator that that language will survive. So we had to take really drastic steps to really protect this. But as we started to grow and all the elements came in, you start to see that effect and impact, because all those experiences the children have subliminal messages about the power of their language. Should I say that again? Mm-hmm. All those experiences the children have plant subliminal messages about the power of their language. So if you see nothing but English on the TV, it sends a message to children. If they can't see programming, some cartoons, or it sends a message. If they don't have apps that kids use, if they don't go out on the street and hear Hawaiian, it sends a subliminal message that their language is in a very small circle. And children aren't analyzing it like us, they're just experiencing it as part of their life experience. So we really want to be thinking about, what do we do today that's preparing for tomorrow that would take us a few steps farther than we are today by the decisions that we're making? So we'll go with that. Aloha. If you can, kind of sit in small groups, because there's going to be a couple of discussion questions that I'm going to ask you to have. You want to have a sit with a partner or a couple of people in your language or across language that you feel comfortable with. So this is an old traditional saying, kamo opuna I kialo. The yalo is, this is my yalo here. And for those of you that in your family or personally were raised by your elders, you know how important that is in the dynamics of revitalizing your language. Some of the most prolific maintainers of our language had the fortune of being raised by their grandparents. Their worldview has been a little bit different than being raised by parents, because they've been raised with much more older knowledge. And those people have had really strong contacts with their language. And I think of the people that have been involved with our language that have been able to maintain, have really had some deep seeds planted by our elders about the importance of the language. And some of that has been through their trauma. You know, they planted those seeds of regret that make you really want to make it better. You know, or just all of the wisdom and advisement that grandparents give. That role in our thinking is that when we keep our grandchildren at the face of our thinking, that in fact, we are actually perpetuating our family legacy into future generations in a way that we're thinking about that whole preparedness of the children for the next generation. And our elders had a very strong role in that, in traditional terms. It's gotten much more difficult because our families are much more transient. You know, before you'd have multiple generations in communities, in the homes. Nowadays, you've got your grandparents living in one community, your family living. So you almost have to create some of those kinds of environments that may not be your biological family, but in order to revitalize your language, that same thinking philosophy can be applied to your learning environments, your school environments, and creating those kinds of families. And they're kind of an extended families, but they've worked for us because they've helped us to build our capacity amongst the numbers that the children have in their circle of language. That make sense? So this is just a reminder with some of the data that we know, that about 85% of the indigenous languages, I think it's around 6,000. Sometimes I hear 7, sometimes I hear a little under 6,000, but the estimate is about 6,000 languages around the world, and about 85% of these are indigenous languages. And they're in the same place that our languages are in. So we know how hard the work is, and we know where we're destined to if we do not do some drastic measures in terms of our language today for our generations of tomorrow. So the rule of a one generation to be endangered, I think I've talked about this at every single one of my presentations because it's really, really important. That in one generation, your language become an endangered status. And I think we've all experienced that, just from grandparents not speaking the native language to their children. You know, so you get to my generation, my father's generation is a gap generation. Then down to your grandchildren, where now, oh my God, if we don't do something, we won't have a language to pass on to our next generation. But we know that it takes three generations to revitalize a language. And the revitalization of a language, when it's vital, means that you can speak across a minimum of those three generations. So from grandparent to parent to child. Grandparent to child to grandchild. That within that household, you will hear your language spoken in a natural, full way across generations. So this picture over here is myself, my eldest daughter, and my eldest granddaughter. This was our presentation we did a couple years ago, a keynote for the NIEA. And I like to think, you know, I think when we started, I couldn't even visualize that far because our language is so endangered. But as I think back, I think we made some good choices to prepare for the future generation. And I think there are some things, if we were kind of thinking like that, past the immediate, that we might have been a little bit even farther along. So maybe that's something that you could glean from our experience and have discussions and think about for your own language circumstance. But this is what we know, that living healthy languages are spoken across three generations. This is something else I've been talking a lot about, and I think it's really important. This whole idea of learning through a language, or speaking through a language, or learning of a language, or about a language, that all of those are important. You know, we at home, some people just want to be able to know enough about Hawaiian to say, oh, Hawaiian has lots of vowels in it, and I can pronounce the word Vaianuenue, that's our main street leading up to my house. And my niece's name is Pualani, and I can pronounce it right, so it sounds good to the ear. People recognize I'm a local person. Or others, the tourists that come or visiting for a while and just want to be respectful to the language. They want to know just basically about, and that's all the goal is for language. That will not, it will not ensure your language to another generation. Then the of is really important. That's what we do in formal institutions of learning, right? You learn of a language. The grammar, the syntax, the vocabulary, and improving that, really important. But we also know that universities, as an of practice, have not been a sole strategy to ensure the revitalization of a language, right? They've helped to increase capacity, but that cannot be the sole strategy. But the through strategy is a strategy, it's a thing that our elders did. They lived through the language. And that transformation of us going from English speakers to learning of a language to be having that become our language, that transformation is a transformational experience. But it's one that my children never think of it, I think, as their mother went through that transformational journey because they only had Hawaiian growing up in the house. So as far as they're concerned, they've told us this a million one times. As we've talked to them from the time they're little about our language being endangered and how important it is that they continue on, and our family discussions around that, and we take them to the legislature and they tell them, hey, keiki olelo Hawaii, olelo Hawaii, vale no mako makahali. I'm a Hawaiian speaker, we only speak Hawaiian at home. And then later, as we're talking about the preciousness of our endangered language, as adults, they're telling us, this is what they're telling us, we don't look at it like that. Because we grew up in a period where the language was spoken to us. So we don't see it endangered in the same light you did. That has been your experience. We've been involved in a time where language has been all around us. We recognize that we need to increase the numbers, but our experience has not been one of language loss. It has been one of language gain. And so that's a very different kind of perspective to be looking at their language. And it's a different kind of role, I think, that they're thinking that they need to do with their own children. So that is how to increase that capacity and mass through their role as parents. And as ours is just like every little thing. What do we call that thing? I don't know what that word is. What did Larry just use the word? Evolution. You know, we've got new words we've got to deal with. And that we have to make up because they're new concepts that are taught in schools. And then we have old knowledge. You know, they have to do some of that walk as well. But the way that you're looking at it is a little bit different. Isn't that interesting? Okay, so this video is called the Aukahi Olelo Hawaii, and it really talks about Olelo Hawaii as a movement. And I'm just trying to pull some clips to move us up to this discussion that I want to get us to, just as an example for you to think about. Oh, it isn't. I thought you didn't have this.
From the classroom to the workplace, to the airwaves, and once again in our very own homes. Kiona ni no ola Hawaii. And while the Pulana Leo are a network of preschools, they are also the foundation of this great Hapukai or movement. Ensuring that our Olelo Hawaii will continue to thrive, a movement that started at a critical point in time back in the mid-80s.
There was sort of a synergy
that's
going on. And that the Kupuna were realizing that there was a lot of people supporting. And then the younger people were part of that boomer generation. It was a time of the Vietnam War, civil rights, so everyone was examining what had happened to various peoples, smaller peoples in the world, so young Hawaiians are really thinking about what happened. How come my grandma can speak Hawaiian and I can't? Those two forces came together at the university, but also in the community. We've had Hawaiian in the university since the 1920s because the community was so strong, the Hawaiian community wanted it in the universities. But it wasn't until this idea of teaching through Hawaiian as a medium of education really caught on. The university has started to really fulfill its role in terms of revitalizing Hawaiian.
Can't you hear work today? No, she's off
idle. ina alai la kokako ini alai ka ike ho no kena.
This sense of kuleana and desire to give back to the community and the aokahi is characteristic of Punana Leo graduates.
We have to put ourselves into these positions, and we also have to turn around and help people get here.
Nurturing keiki and lifelong learners of all ages through our lalo Hawaii, who are groomed to take on various kuleana. To better our Hawaii for the future. The Punana Leo are more than just preschools. They are leading a growing and cycling movement in aokahi to ensure our olelo Hawaii will live on.
Videos historically over the last 35 years and helping to put it in pieces for us to come out and share with you, and even mostly, really importantly, amongst ourselves, because sometimes we don't think of our work as a movement, but it is a movement. And sometimes we just worried about our language warrior roles and how that is really being absorbed through the life experience of our children. And at the same time, we knew that if we addressed our olelo, that one issue that we was very important to us, and we rallied really tight around that, that we'd have some progress because we're committed to that. What we didn't know is what would be the outcomes of that. You know, we have 100% graduation rate and no attrition in our schools. But amongst Native Hawaiians in our state, that's high. You know, so it varies someplace between, depending on the high school, between about 83 to about 88% of our high school graduates go on to college. We have one now that's is a faculty at Oxford University doing brain work on languages. I mean, you don't know where it ends up. You know, we have teachers, we have physicians, we have those going into law. And so they will hopefully also continue that pathway of language to take it into those workforce areas. And it's gotten us really thinking at the university about general core courses taught through Hawaiian. Mm-hmm. You know, and the university is thinking, why do you want to do that? And what doctorates are going to teach that? And we're saying, doctors don't necessarily teach general core at 100 level. That's many a times taught by BA graduates at a lecturer level. Or now with college credits at high school, early college can be taught by high school teachers as early college credits. It's being done in English. We could do that in Hawaii. We got some great high school teachers teaching. And we may not be able to do everything, but we may be able to do some things to connect that bridge for our students from high school into college, and also strengthen that whole pathway, because that's the weakest link. We want to have more students think of education as the vehicle for further revitalization of our Olelo, and then what they do with that in their community and their lives. You had a question you wanted to ask me?
Yeah, I just wanted to know if you had kept like data. Was there like a decrease in like drug use and suicides?
We haven't done that statistics. It would be really interesting to do that. So I'll make two comments. One is our rates have been high. Our early classes were small, might have been half a dozen to 10 students. Our current classes are between 20, 30 students. So over that last week, we're seeing more students stick. Now, elementary, we have big numbers. And Maui's gonna have a four kindergarten classes coming in. But the high school is much more challenging to sustain because you need more content masters. So, I mean, if I were to be thinking about now, preparing for high school, I would be figuring about ways to help support your students that are double majoring. As language, in the language, the fluency in their language, as well as their content knowledge, because they're gonna be the ones that's going to help take it into the workforce and be your teachers for secondary. That's been our biggest challenge. And that's where our, some families have chosen at high school to take their children out to that. So that's been a weekly, because that's a harder place. Elementary has been easy to fill in comparison to secondary. I say elementary, middle school hasn't been too hard, but high school has been much harder. One, the teacher to student ratio is different. It's higher, you know, so I think it's 20-1 in kindergarten to second grade. You know, high school is 30-35 per teacher. And then you need to have several grade levels of that grade. So just the mathematics of how the budget has been challenging, but these are things I think you might be able to be thinking about and planning for, and find ways to get funding to help support them, because their journey is harder than everybody else's. The expectation of double majors, the time in college, the cost is more than others, but you need them. And so I'm just throw a couple of things out from our experience for you to be thinking about. Might be a great grant project to think about. So I didn't quite answer your question. We haven't done that statistic, probably because we felt like we really didn't have a strong need, but actually it's a really good question, because we haven't had that much problems with drug abuse. And but yet, I'd say 70% or above in our immersion schools come from socioeconomical struggling families. So that may be an indicator in itself of something healthy. So just a really quick glimpse of that history that was in that video to have you see how that span across law and policy and the development of our P-20 model. And so the P-20 model is around this idea. I have some things I've been saying at every presentation because I might auto leave with it. Here's the other one. We in Hawaii have two official languages. We therefore should be able to have two official pathways to education. It's going to be more of a challenge with 20 official languages, but you know, in your area, it's something to think about, because there is some precedence that is set when your language becomes an official language. But now, you folks are going to have to push that envelope a little bit. What that means in terms of policy and funding and support for schooling. Something to think about. These are our 30-year statistics. So I like this one, because you can see where that changes over the term of our movement, beginning with our numbers of native speakers here in 1983 of under the age of 18 and native speakers. that statistics at 3,000 keiki is not the total number of speakers. Is we actually use the total number of enrollment is actually over that that's in our immersion schools now. Just to give you a little comparison, and our native speakers look at the numbers, and we think that's generous. We kind of use a 15 number, but when we sit down and count, it's under 20. Because those elders that are left are really our gap generation. And the bulk of those speakers were either raised by their grandparents or most likely grew up in very rural areas of our island where, you know, they were be able to maintain Hawaiian a little bit more as the language of the home and the community, but very small numbers. So we really, in our movement now, are really driven by second language speakers. See, you have some advantages now that we never had. Some of your languages have way more speakers than we did starting off, really. And then where we are today, we really cannot depend on our elder generation to be the ones to hold our hands, except for all the knowledge and repository that we can go back to. So we have mostly now second language speakers raising children as first language speakers. Think about that. Think about what the differences in language would be as a second language speaker raising a first language speaker, and where we have to go with that. Because these children look at themselves as native speakers. And they hear the old folks' language and they can see some different, but there's still room for growth and improvement. That's kind of an interesting thought. And for many of our languages, that's where we're gonna be at too. Second language speakers raising first language. One of the other things we didn't think of, I think it was in our gut that that direction would also have impact, the direction of revitalizing our language would have impact in other areas. One of those areas is the general well-being of our people. Because the most vibrant time in our history was when our language was our national language and it was used everywhere. Business, commerce, education, everywhere. And that one solid blow, 3 years after the overthrow of our government, just tumbled all of those positive statistics. And so language just has such a powerful impact on a people. And when you get down to the bottom layers, it really affects this whole general well-being. And I think you can think of your own examples of where that's applied. So language revitalization also helps to revitalize and strengthen our own native well-being. I'm going to give you an example. This is our laboratory school, Nawahio Kalani Opu'u. This, Kaanpu'ular College, has four laboratory schools. The one closest to our university is Nawahio Kalani Opu'u. So this little clip kind of gives you a general sense. You can see what the school looks like to get a sense of what it might look and feel like in just a glimpse of a clip.
The basic reason that you need to put an extreme amount of effort into maintaining Hawaiian is that English is so super overpowering in our contemporary society in Hawaii. So in order to make Hawaiian strong, you have to put an extra effort into that.
nestled in Puna on the island of Hawaii, Ke Kuʻu o Kalani Opuʻu is home to a preschool through 12th grade program pursuing academic success from a solid foundation in our language and culture. All modeled after one of Hawaii's legendary figures. Born and raised in the school's home of Puna, Joseph Kohoʻoluhi Namahiʻo Kalani Opuʻu served his people in many ways as a legislator, a lawyer, and even a newspaper publisher.
E kuʻu hoʻohalike o Namahi ma muli o kona ano he kanaka aloha lahui o ka mua. A leila aloha aina, aloha hoʻonaʻoa.
I kou mana o oia ka waiwai nui o keia papahana o ka nuu kia o ke kula no anehi ko ka kuola, no ka mea no anehi nei noa.
The school is grounded in traditional Hawaiian ways of thinking, but its philosophy of education is anything but old. Namahiʻo Kalani Opuʻu is building on the state's existing Hawaiian immersion program to create a 100% Hawaiian medium experience.
Now, Hawaiian medium education goes beyond the classroom to include the entire school. That means the librarian, the janitor, and the principal, everyone using Hawaiian as the language of the school.
Puli. Puli.
Puli.
And that's really the idea of Hawaiian medium education, to be normal, to have Hawaiian language and culture normalized, to be on TV.
Hello, how may I go? He mea poʻi koʻi maoli no ke ninu nei pili na aina lia liʻi.
To be in the grocery store.
Ka mea hoʻomake aka, ai au ka hapuna i o ka ai.
And of course to be in school.
Ai.
This all allows for a high level of fluency that's beneficial on many levels.
Well, first there's a cultural benefit of being able to live your life in Hawaiian language from a Hawaiian perspective, totally from a Hawaiian point of view. However, there's also academic benefits. Research has shown throughout the world that children who know two languages really, really well have a cognitive advantage over all other children.
Namahi Leadership is working with institutions and agencies such as the Educational Testing Service to help develop valid and reliable measures that confirm these advantages of a Namahi Hawaiian medium education.
Ka poʻe hapu poʻike nui ko lākou hoihoi i ka ʻike i ka poʻe ʻōiwi e imi i kaikana i kekahi hoʻike e hoʻike aʻu wale ana i ke aha mai. O kēia mau keiki e aʻu ia nei ma loko o ka lākou ʻōlelo ʻōiwi.
This cutting-edge educational opportunity involves and appeals to families young and old from a variety of backgrounds.
We wanted our children to have the experience of being educated in Hawaiian language and Hawaiian culture. We felt that having that experience would allow them to develop the other skills and academic success that they needed to be successful in today's environment.
Nui kahana, but it was worth it. And the thing is, my father's generation and my generation, you know, we lost the language. So that's why we needed to bring it back. And the reason why I wanted Kopa to go to ʻōlelo Hawaii school was to bring back the language in our ʻohana.
ʻAʻole kēia no nā ʻohana apau, aka no mākou ka poʻe i koho i kēia ana hoʻonaʻoʻo. He mea nui loa kēia no ke ola o ka ʻike o Kopa ko mā kupuna no kēia hanaona hou.
For many of our ʻohana, this experience begins with the Punana Leo preschool program.
Makiʻalo he noʻonoʻo ka maka o ka pepe kawanawa. Ke rapae pepe o ia ka wā e hoʻomākai.
Ka
i ka apu wai. A me ka makau kau o ke kanaka. I ka hoʻokele ana i kāna hana. kana la vena, kana mau olelo, kahiki ke ike maikai, ka ho'oholo mana o ana, ke kia ana manuno ka hana. Aie I loko ka olelo, kia mau mea ho'oloa.
Ai, ai, oe!
The entire Nāwahi environment fosters this way of learning, from the educational approaches and strategies to the physical environment as well.
In Hawaiian thinking, learning teaches everywhere. So the garden, in that respect, is one of our most precious classrooms here in Nāwahi. Math is very abstract in that you have to, you know, take numbers and crunch them, and that's what people typically think about math.
Oh,
the model allows us to apply it to real life situations. So one example would be just measuring the growth of the wala plant, which then allows us to plan better with our certain gathering. It's not just going through the motions, but actually applying that knowledge to your work, to your life.
Kanaka ike, oyeke kanaka ihiki ke kalailai ike kahi mea ke kai anu ike po aia pini. A oyeke pu ike la kanaka hokai ke hoohana maoli ike la ike ma ke kahi anu. A oe vai vai o ka ike vale o ke po o a hiki ke palaau a ka a ale mapoko pihea e hoohana ike la ike. No leila, o ka ike kuuna o ia, ia ano no'o no'o. Loa ko'u ike no kia no ka mea ho'ohana wau ike e ike.
And it's that practical application of traditional ways of thinking about contemporary content that's key to this Nāwahi educational experience.
I don't know what happened. I showed this before, I think it didn't all load up, but is there anything in that video that you see valuable for thinking about and using in what you've been discussing about next steps for your own languages?
When I hear that the garden is the best classroom, immediately I think of our tundra, taking kids out.
It's a whole world of difference, learning from a textbook and being out in that environment to apply a math and science. These you know very well, because you've still been able to maintain those parts in there. I think for schooling generally, and this has application to our languages in this educational path, sometimes we get so wrapped up in all the multitude of things they need to learn that we forget that all of those are umbrellaed under some really important concepts where content and skills link up for life application. So we kind of rethinking of that with our own cultural lens, it really gives us a framework for thinking a little bit different about our programs through our languages. Anything else? Hi.
Yeah, I have a question. So one of the things I struggle with is, you know, our knowledge systems are so inclusive of everything, right? We have a way of transferring our knowledge that includes this kids from biology, environmental science,
and when we, how are you transitioning your kids to be able to go into the academia? And because they don't understand how our knowledge is, they think that has to do, in my sense, with a cultural way of looking at education.
Yeah.
And so many a times in our Western experience, education is very siloed, and we assuming that they're linking up the pieces to figure out how they all fit in a bigger piece. So what I'm saying is, be less afraid of having to address all the many things that they don't get the end piece, and focus on the better quality in the whole piece. Because they start to see, I mean, math, what's my worst subject? I'm terrible at math. But I do understand that good mathematicians, I think I said this at the last one, good mathematicians see math everywhere. Mm-hmm. So do good scientists. I mean, so our stories. I mean, language lives in whole contexts. And so that has something to do with how we look at how we formulate our schools. And to be less afraid of having to silo and thinking that it won't get them to academics, but really to have that be the foundation of how we relook at education. So I really, I'm gonna say this again, I think that if we were to look more conceptually at the bigger ideas and that the academics, the content and the skills align to that with application in exhibition or demonstrated learning, that we still stay closer to our native ways of education, but yet that's the place we want them to be anyway, that they can see the connection because we've given them lots of practice in the connection. Here's another. Academics isn't the whole picture. That there's nothing worse than looking at our children and know that they got the academics, but they have lousy behaviors, they have lousy attitudes, they're not the kind of citizens we want to be educating for the future in that way. That's part of our what we need to look at. So if you looked at this film, you can kind of see the children had this kind of sense of responsibility for their own learning. And yet, very lots of group-oriented things, very natural for us. But we know they're gonna have to work like that in the outside world. Mm-hmm. Those are human skills that you need in our world today. And so we need to put them in environments where that what they're gonna need to have for tomorrow is their experiences of what they have to do, but we're gonna frame it and guide it through our own native philosophy, beliefs, values. And those really take conversations you folks have to have. You have to have those conversations. They sound lofty and nice, but what does that really look like and what the curriculum looks like? What strategies I'm looking at? What are the rituals, the ceremonies, the routines that happen in the school environment? How do I work with the parents to feel like they are part of the school? They're not dropping their kids off, but they must be part of that educational process. So, I mean, sometimes we talk about that importance, but we don't necessarily do that in our schools. So I think for us, that's been one of our really important strategies. And amongst Hawaiian immersion and medium schools, they are well known to have the highest percentage of family participation amongst all the public schools. So we say if we're gonna revive our language, we cannot do it without the parents. You are their first teachers. So you need to we all walk together in this journey. And I think that's a really important strategy as well.
Watching this, I got inspired to sing our native hymns and our also native traditional songs to our children. So what are some of the advice can you give me to teach our younger children, toddlers, our native songs?
Those that are important to you are part of the way you run your program and the content of your program. We have had a little struggle in the formal setting of traditional. If the government looks at it as part of content, they don't have problems with it. But if we're talking about, there is a part in, a strong part of spirituality that's in our chants, our songs, and we cannot deny that Christianity has been part of our culture from my grandparents' generation. So that is part of our history. So, I mean, we've had a lot of big talks about that because traditional old religion is becoming more and more something you're seeing. And almost Christianity is kind of the indoctrination process, colonization process, and we want less of that. But the truth is it's part of our history. And it's hard to deny parts of your history. So every morning, the school gathers. Faculty, staff, office workers, custodians, all at the Pico area, at the umbilicus of our campus. We do that up at the university 3 times a week. It's a little bit more difficult with university because they're coming in and out. But our schools, they're with them all day. and they meet there, and there is a protocol that they all go through for preparing themselves mentally, spiritually, for the goal of education and what that means. So there are traditional songs, chants that are done at the Pico that have really deep meaning tied to, directly to education. There even is prayer at the Pico, because we've chosen to keep and honor all those pieces in our history, our cultural history and our language history as well. And so there have been some questions from the Department of Education about prayer in the school. So our explanation, because you could say that for the Hawaiian traditional side, and you could say that for the other side. So what we've chosen to see around that is part of our cultural practice that we link to language arts. And they stop bothering us. I mean, you can study in college, right? You can study the Bible as part of your content in college. So we've just, how we explain and articulate those connections, if it's something of value, we have to figure out how to articulate it. That because there is a way of looking at education that is different than our frame of education, and we have to be able to connect those pieces so that those that are providing the funding and listening to our programs feel that we are addressing those areas of need that we need to, and we're not infringing on any kinds of civil rights and those kinds of privileges that we need to pay attention to. But we don't want to ignore them because somebody else outside of that says you can't do that. If it's something that is important to the school, and every school will make a little bit different decision. So I'm going to assume all of your communities and languages are going to make decisions around that. And I think that's healthy, but it helps us to get to a better place of articulation. And that articulation includes our own families. When I was in the classroom, I opened up the first immersion site on the island of Maui, and I had parents, Jehovah's Witness are very strict about not celebrating birthdays and any other kinds of gods. So I really had to explain to them where Pele comes in, you know, our goddess of the volcano, where she comes in into that whole cultural arena of thinking. I didn't lose one child. So what I'm trying to say is the articulation of how you make those connections is really important. Because they didn't see it as, oh, she's teaching religion to my children, because that's the family's responsibility. But she's hooking it in a way that the child is seeing the frame of how our old folks saw those connections to the earth and our spirituality, and then tying it too with the science and the social studies to have that academic connection to it. So the point is we have to figure out how to articulate that better. Because our model has really been what I'm starting to call a lot more an ohana to ohana model. Meaning that the model really began with our families. If we did not have our families, we would not have had our movement. It would not have been able to happen if schools said, oh, we're just gonna do this and do a regular enrollment. We opened up schools where there was interest coming in and commitment from families and communities. So we had a critical mass. And that whole beginning at the home, and you saw that in the video beginning with the little babies, is really important. And that whole connection of the family that demonstration of their own commitment and view of the importance of Olelo Hawaii, of revitalizing our language, goes from parent to child, or goes from grandparent to grandchild. So that first base of it being very, what we're calling family-based education, and taking that philosophy into the formal structure of the institution from the lower ed education, then that bridge into higher education, into workforce, back to community and family. That I think that cycle is really important, and if we're thinking about it in that cycle, maybe our decisions around how the role of family, the importance of family, and then coming back to impact the change in the vitality of our families and our communities. That's kind of a nice rounded picture. So this one, I thought I'd pull a couple samples. So this is my son, my number two child, and this is his number three child, his son, Kalahi Kiola. And I found this really interesting little audio clip when we used to take them to Larry's Kaleo Hawaii radio program that was conducted every Sunday, only in Hawaiian, mostly had elders. But this particular one, he wanted to address, to introduce to our radio public what was happening in immersion education. So he invited a few of us mothers, and I was there when I listened to the tape. Boy, I'm so glad my Hawaiian has become much better. But it was so humbling to remind me that we all have a place to begin. And through the process, we all get better and better because we're actively involved in that process. And so I thought I would play that clip, and then I'm going to play one of my, this is, I think he's about a year and a half in here. And you can hear the voices of my husband and I and my son kind of talking to him about his body part. So just that modeling that happens, that begins in the family, in the ohana. So he said, I'm Kamal, Kamal Hiva, he gave his whole name. He said, I'm 3 years old. He said, my mom is Auntie Keiki. And my father was Clement Benedict. And he said, well, where do you go to school? He said, where do you go to school? He said, I go to school in Punanaleo. He says, who are your teachers? And he starts naming, you can tell it's very natural. Mm-hmm. You know, for a three-year-old, it's pretty fluent at that point. This was at the beginning of our movement. So we pretty much had a parent to a child generation from the majority of the families. Some families were fortunate, had grandparents. Mm-hmm. And for the bulk of our grandparent generation, it was a healing rediscovery generation. And I'm so glad that you had made that apology yesterday, and I had bings. Because we never come to apologize for the hurt that, and that not no thinking about the impact that it has made on with my father's generation and in our generation. They're all really, the trauma affects multi-generations. And so in order to kind of cleanse that pathway to be focused and think, we need to acknowledge that so we can move on. So this next one, you can hear just talking about the body parts. Now, what I do want to say is, his mother is not a Hawaiian speaker. My son right now is a single parent, so he's got Hawaiian in his home, but when he goes to visit his mother, you know, they have all English. And that family is a very American family, monolingual. Mm-hmm. So what does that mean for our role now as parents and grandparents? To ensure that he still, that gift can be transferred to him as well as it is with my other grandchildren. My oldest daughter, the father, has taken on the cause and they speak only Hawaiian in their home. So I thought this would be a good sample so you can see what that kind of example looks like. Where's your belly button? Pito! My pico! Pico! Maiki mai! Kina? Mame komaka! Like that! Open your eyes! Aka mai oi! Yeah. And my husband's going, put your eyes your nose? Where's your nose? So, I mean, and you have to talk to them, even though their family experience may be different. I'm talking this whole thing of the three generation, as if he is a total speaker. Mm-hmm. And we don't make excuses for that. Because what will end up is, naturally, they'll all be bilingual or multilingual speakers. That's going to be a given if they have the richness of the language in the home. And we know from the statistics on language learning that you can learn 3 to 5 languages between the age of 8 and 10 if you have good quality language. So that now becomes the role that my husband and I play to make sure he has as rich language as the other grandchildren, even though his mother's side will continue to speak English. And she's sort of coming warm to words, because we never can guarantee that our children are gonna marry other people or be with other people that choose our language warrior path. Some do and some don't. But our grandchildren, we want to ensure that they have that language to go on. And I just thought that might be nice to have some comparison samples of what that may look like.
Katie, can I have a quick question?
Sure.
So as a grandparent speaking to your grandchild in your language, do you ever worry if that child will understand or not?
No. Oh, I speak to him as if he knows it. That kind of confidence is what I have to speak to. Because I think, you know, I think there are messages in our confidence or lack of confidence.
Okay.
You may not get it as good, so I'm gonna simplify and downsize my language to this grandchild that I don't need to do with the other, all the same. And when he comes into the home environment, he knows that's what he's gonna get. And it's really interesting, children get it. You know, I can hear, and he goes with his mother, he speaks English. The minute he's walking into, coming up the drive, I go, oh, tutu, tutu. I can hear him already starting to make that change. And when he's with his cousins, he knows his cousins only speak Hawaiian amongst each other. If he wants to be part of that cousin group, he gotta speak Hawaiian. So, I mean, and I want them to think like that. I want them to think, we speak Hawaiian because we go to Hawaiian school and our parents both speak Hawaiian to us. And, but Poating, he only has part of Hawaiian. So we're gonna speak English to him. I don't think that's good for his mojo either. You know, so you want the best quality that you can give as grandparent. They figure out that in this context, it's a little late. And I think they step up to the plate for that. And if you don't, you can see he's happy in it. So I thought that might be interesting to take a look at.
Thank you.
Okay, so this clip is my daughter, the one that you saw in that first picture, with her daughter. This is her second child, and this was recently in March. We had, oh my gosh, we haven't had a speech contest in Hawaiian since the 1990s. And this is our 30th year, and the DOE decided to do some extra things. So my grandson went and competed. Oh my God, he was so nervous. He was so nervous, he's second grade. And so, but he won that level of the speech contest. And I thought I would let you see what that looks like. So he's 7 years old. Going on. Move this up a little bit.
Omeka iaoe.
Ena hoi orane ka olelo o nia ina aloha opo. O o kumoka ka e ka rukua ka vai e a maka I moku ke ke ki a aere na wakarane noia. Noho o ma ke au puna moko ke ae. Aia au ma ka hapa e lua ma ke kula o na fi o kane o puu. E a he o lelaka blana na puna mai ka mo orewa o kalawana. He ala, he aina ala o puna. Noho I hole na ke ki kupo ka aina pala mea ka ala. O ki hole I ka pua kuia ala, a le ane ka ai. Ala kula ka pua umoe. O ki mai lo kahi o moe, kau e ala kari hale ka paia, a pela I ka pua e ko. A pela I ka pua e ko aina o puna pai ale ka hale. Mahalo.
He was so nervous. And when he got home, I said, you know, mea ka o kuku o lalawai? How was the competition? He said, oh, Oh, tu tu wa lulu fa wa lo ke kai ke ka mai ne mai ka i lo a mana o fa e o na fa ya ya ka wala de kila. I was so nervous when I was there. I had another girl, she was way better than me. But I won. You know, all the little things that we do with our best intent sometimes work. So I'm going to have you give you just a few minutes. I'd like you to think about, I'm calling this, what must we do today to revitalize our native languages? So the question is, what are the family, community, and cultural roles and responsibilities for speakers of our language? I just want you to have a simple kind of general conversation about what you think those are for your language circumstances. So turn to a neighbor, you can pair share, or bring in a few from the front and the back. Just some discussion about what you think that is. And revitalizing your language. Then I'm gonna ask for two or three to share out.
Well, I guess, should we join you two?
Oh. Sure.
I don't know who is here.
Did you want to join a group?
Sure.
Oh, we're supposed to be with our family or our language community. I don't have any other input on there. But I think we're pretty much the same.
If there are too many things to think about, focus on just the family or the community or the.
The question I wanted to ask you is, do you have a grandbaby? Can you speak in
Ubeck? As at the very beginning, yes, I did. And that's why I asked that question. I saw that the oldest one, when she was as she was getting older, so
important. Yeah.
But
I like that. Like,
she was learning more and more English. But when she's heard something, then she comes to me and becomes a graduate. My husband and I trained her preschool. But as she got a little bit older, you know, she gets older, I see more English that she's speaking now. But it kind of works. If I didn't be rough with her, then she can understand it. So I switch right away, so I got to fix that mentally, you know, when I get back home. I have to make myself so I need to put her in an in-field speaking circle or environment.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, they just learn so fast. Just so fast. I gotta hit that gap.
Right now.
And, but you know what was happening for parents, her mom especially, wants to interrupt with her. So she knows her they want to use our in-field family, a song, a sentence for father, sister, a yard, mother. So they're using those. It's not
enough.
Yeah. Maddie will help me with my
daughter.
And she's the one, Maddie's the one that's cold. In a pair. Because, you know, with our namesakes, our roles are always switched. And it's something I just have to accept, that reminder. So just
okay, just one more minute.
I love it. like when you said that you could just.
So that's a thing that's gnawing in her gut. That's her history. But she will say often, you've been seeing your tutu often enough, we need to bring more. So, and I think the reason is that she recognized that that's part of his cultural rights that she needs to ensure that he has exposure to. So I think she has a tension in her gut, but the wisdom of side of her is saying, if I'm smart, I'm gonna make sure that my son has the access to that elder knowledge. So it's kind of a weird dynamics, isn't it? But the answer is that she's been better about that. And she's gotten better as she's been around the family with her language more. And I just have to keep my confidence that that child is a speaker of Hawaiian. Mm-hmm. As if he knows no difference. And I talk to her in that same light that I talk to my son-in-law that is a speaker of Hawaiian. And that family started out with, well, Kaneni's a native speaker of Hawaiian. I'm never gonna be that good. So I'm gonna speak English because somebody gotta speak English. And that way they have both languages. But you know what happened? In a blink of an eye, he felt like he was an outsider of that circle. You know, when his kids at the dinner table are laughing up a storm with the mother and he's not part of that conversation, he's got to make some choices. And my husband did the same thing, went through the same process. And I find that as part of, I want to say that's part of the transition process to coming into that path of the language. Thinking, I can't do it, so I'll do this. And then feeling like, wow, this really is gonna be a Hawaiian speaking home. And if I wanna be part of this as a family, then I need to change my attitude around that. Nobody forced him, nobody scolded him. We just let the process do its thing. But we have to keep our confidence and our commitment to the language as something non-negotiable. So I don't scold them, I don't put any of them down for it, but that's what we do in our family. That's what we've done for several generations in our family, and that's what we prize as our grandchildren and generations forward having. So it's kind of like how you set your own behavior and disposition for the work. Any other thing you'd like to share with us?
Hi. I was in Sami Land a couple of years ago, and what they had was, and they're still in the process of doing it, is they had language family camps. There was five different families that would meet throughout the year, and they'd come together and they'd just speak Lami, Sami, and teach each other Sami and see where their kids were progressing. And I thought that was a unique idea.
It's a fabulous idea. We did that in the early years of our movement. I think we called it Leo Aha Leo Mohala, and it was for families across our schools. We have so many now, finding a site to bring them in means some can come and some can't. And we've been talking about reviving that. But in our early years, it was so important. That's how the students got to know other speakers of Olelo Hawaii and other communities. And it also gave those families that were having a little of the struggle of coming in. And to be honest, we all had a struggle coming in. Even our elders did, because they now were involved in something that they had not done for a long time. So, but I love that, and I think that's something to continue. Folks have language. Some of you have language camps, right? So you sort of have, you have camps, right?
Have cultural camps.
Cultural camps. But you can do cultural camps through your language, right? And then begin to invite some of the family. If you just use that as one of your strategies for building capacity amongst your families. And also what will happen with that is building support for your movement. Watch our time. So the Department of Education recently has been restructuring their own thoughts about education. And one of the things that they did is they moved Hawaiian studies from five layers down in the organization up to the superintendent's table. When that happened, now they have the ear of the superintendent instead of having to go so many layers down where they don't have much leverage, putting it up at the top. And what that has created is discussions about the direction of the Department of Education in the education of Hawaii's children. And from that came this discussion, and the bulk of the strength of this has actually been gleaned out of Hawaiian-focused charter schools and Hawaiian medium and immersion schools. That's what informed this discussion. And the reason why they really were thinking about it is because those schools have produced so much success in their children. So we may not know the exact statistics, but we know that schools aren't having big drug problems. They're going on to college, they're showing up at school, they're graduating, which hasn't been an experience for several. What are they doing that's different? And what is their thinking about it? So this idea of Hawaii being the foundation of our learning actually just took all of the, it neutralized the tension of Native Hawaiians against all other nationalities. So we use that verbiage, Hawaii is the foundation of our learning, to refocus on our children in their place and the quality of education they need as future leaders of Hawaii. But in order to do that, they also know that looking at Hawaii as a foundation, they are going to have to address language and culture, because it's not in Texas. So it was a strategy to actually bring back the balance of Olelo and our culture, our values being part. And this is that, remember I was talking about that idea of two official languages, two official pathways? Mm-hmm. So this diagram came out of those kinds of discussions. And one of our past Board of Education members, she now has finished her term, she actually, after listening to all us, came to our Aha Kauleo, which is the Hawaiian Medium, Hawaiian Immersion Advisory Council, and said, you know, I've been listening, I've been attending meetings across the state, and listening and thinking, and she didn't say use this two official language, two pathways to education, but I've been thinking, but she brought this diagram to us, and I actually found it, that, okay, so the English medium has a pathway that goes across lower education, leading into the bridge of career and college, but so does immersion. Mm-hmm. And maybe if we spend more attention to allow both of these to grow where they need to be growing, instead of assuming this is in here, maybe we start to learn things that can be shared between the two pathways. that actually benefit the whole of education. And so I share that with you because what I'm saying is, doing our models of school through our language also has informed and improved the thinking of our Department of Education. So you have Alaskan standards. You folks have done lots of standards and values, but you haven't done it just to make pretty posters. You want those to be at the foundation of what is applied in schools and what is that benefit for all children in Alaska. And I want to say for our language that we need to think of growing this, but not against that, because our children play with those children. Mm-hmm. Our children are in the same communities as the children. By lifting this outward, so do we begin to expand and lift language in the broader sense of our community. So as important as I understand that to be a Native issue, and it's important, it also is an issue and a strategy to revitalize our languages. By thinking of the many, by thinking of us, and being open to share and helping in that articulation of what it is we're doing. We're actually educating a paradigm shift for education. So they have a whole new set of, I did my last presentation, I kept coming to it, it's just like bing, set of pillars that they're calling the Ha, the Hopenabo. So if you Google this, I think you're gonna have to do Hawaii DOE. You can look for yourself what the DOE has done with this framing of thinking in restructuring a whole set of learner outcomes, the pillars of those ideas that they're rethinking about what that means for school. Because our schools have had so much success, they're trying to figure out what can they take from that to improve the other. Isn't that interesting? When at the beginning of our movement it was, are they really doing academics? Are the children really being prepared for adult life? Are they creating and dealing with critical thinking? And now they're coming back and saying, what are they doing there that we're not doing here? Maybe we need to take a look at some of those things that are happening here and relook at how we implement those in our own schools. Isn't that exciting? So this last piece, we're up to our last 10 minutes, are sort of some of my reflections that I've kind of gleaned over the last 30 years. So let me see if I can go over them really quickly. The first is that Oka'olelo ke ka'au kamoli, that our language really is the binding force of our own cultural life force. That we know already. I don't need to talk more about that. We understand, but it's something we need to remember as one of our own pillars of thinking, that as we align them to whatever you folks decide to do with your own work ahead of you. That makahana ka'ike, these are old knowledges, that knowledge comes from direct experience. Family, school, community work together for the success of the child and betterment of the community. So thinking of the many instead of focusing on just me, myself, and I actually applies to the me. But it has impact more to lift the many. Does that make sense? Ho'okulu mai ka olelo, that renormalizing endangered languages require one's use, practice, and living through the language in all those kinds in the revitalization of our languages. You know, the of, about, or through, they all have pieces of importance. I think our biggest focus is going to be to get us where we want is the through. Nobody else can do that from us. Other people can do the of and the about, but only those of us that are speakers and language warriors in our community can lead the through and build more capacity towards that. Ko'i ko'i ka pilina ka nu'ukia me ka lokahi. I'm going to put any of your Alaskan Native languages there in place of Hawaiian. And that is that attention to our relationships, the adherence to our own visions that we have for our language, and our unification, our collective work, is really essential in the resiliency of our language for the future. And this is the last one. I love this one. And actually, the Māori used this for many years. I just added a little phrase more. Eola ka'olelo I na manawa po, manawahi a po, mana po ayopili a po. Means that a living language is spoken everywhere, in all places, and in all contexts. It's a place that we can grow to. It's also a place we can build from where we know. But the more you do it and walk with that confidence, the more confident actually you become. This is a piece of a recent video on where we sort of are in our movement. I think it's got some nice pieces. This was actually taken in the legislature in
April.
Maia ba I ho ana hou ia I ke kumukana vai o ka moku aina o Hawaii. A meia ho ana hou ana, I ho aku helu ia I ka olalo Hawaii. Oia ke kahi o na olalo kuhelu e lua o ka moku aina. Uho oia I opu ia ka vai vai o ka hoona o wao ia ana o ke keiki, maka ike mo o meheu a olalo Hawaii. Mana kula o kuni apa o Hawaii. Mana kanavaru no I hoʻomaka kula na mana leo hope o ia wā, me ke kahi puʻulu o pio, e alu like a imi I ala e ora hou ai ka olalo makuahine, ma ka hoʻonaʻauau ana I na kamaliʻi ma ka olalo Hawaiʻi. A makamaka hiki ʻumikūmaiwa kanavaru kumaono I hoʻopuli ia I ke kanawai I pāpā I ka olalo Hawaiʻi ma ke kula. Ai kēia wā a no, ua hiki he hoʻonaʻauau ia ke keiki mai ka hiʻi pēpē a hiki loa I ka papahana laiʻula ma ka olalo Hawaiʻi.
Ua paʻa mai la he home no ke koleke o ka hapaʻula o ke ʻelikolani o hale olalo no ia.
No leila, ua ulu nui na ʻohana ma ka papahana, na keiki ma ka papahana, a ma muli o ka ulu nui, pono leila ana kumu hoʻoaʻe.
Kana ka pau e noho ana maha reine. E komo ana ka pau I loko ke la mautana.
kēia ka wā e kūri noa, e paipai I nā haumāna, e hoʻike ka lana ki lau ka papahana, e hoʻomau I pahana, a piʻi mau I lākou, a komo ma ke ala I hoihoi a lākou, ma ka oihana I hoihoi a lākou, a ka maka olelo Hawaii, ai hoʻomaka koho I kēlā, ai ʻike maka, maka wā pāhihi, a maka wā a ume ume, e hoʻomana wenu, a I kuhaʻa.
Aloha, maka waino!
O ke kai mea e ane ka nona o ana na me lili I o ka lā, maka hale, ma ke kai unu e kokua e maka hoʻo nui ana e ka he luna poe, e awango ai ke ia, a nono ai ka poe, o ka olelo Hawaii, ka home, ka olelo o iwi o ka aina, kona ka poe a pau e awango ma ke kai ana. Ina make make kako e I kai ka hoa I ka olelo. Pono e olelo Hawaii e ka poe a tau. A pono kako e kukua I ka poe e ho ea I mela.
Our senator is sitting there with a hakalama.
Kia a ka hiki no. A oe poe I mana o iki ai e ho ea mai ana I ki a loa. Wa ho ea mai. Nui loa ka hana I koi ni a ka na ka poe o pia o ki ia wā a me ka ko e o o mau a nao nao I loko ka e whakamu o makahiki mahi ana ka ko. I loko o ka umi o makahiki ke piha ka olelo Hawaii ke kana lima makahiki olelo ma ke kula pihelo o ki ia moko ai mahi ana ka ko makahia ana I kana lima makahiki.
Some things to think about in closure where we are with our olelo. So I hope this will give you some seeds of thought to be thinking about in your work forward. I really want to thank you folks about your patience because I feel like, man, we've done so many presentations over the last 3 days that I'd kind of be sick of hearing about Hawaii after this. But you know, our desire is really to help you with what experience we have to offer up. Mahalo nui loa ia o ko apau ki e hui ana. Aloha.